Brooklyn Independent Television.
I've been following the solo records.
Okay.
And I've been loving it. Shock City Maverick.
Yeah.
Which is a little old.
Yeah, that was the last song. That was the last record I did for Warp. Girlways and instigator, insubordinated, devastating, radiating, golden phonetic, pyrotechnic, author of your obituary, adversary of the arbitrary, bury a thousand once spread and limited vision, limp brains, wrinkle under the strain, just as easily as writing my name. And then I put out an independent one called Thorns. And then the next one is coming out in February.
Okay.
On the 15th. That's okay. Called End It All.
End It All. And yeah. Okay. So you go from Shock City Maverick to Thorns
to End It
to
All.
End It All. So what arc is that?
Well, that's, honestly,
I don't know, dude. That's like,
well, Thorns was dealing with a lot of things, you know, tumultuous in my life, and that's why I called it Thorns. And it's, Thorns is the most like personal upfront album. And then End It All, you know, I was gonna stop doing this.
You're gonna stop doing hip hop.
I was gonna stop doing music. Period.
For real.
For real. I was thinking maybe, you know, get into something, try and do something else.
Like what?
That's the dilemma. I haven't thought about it. Anything that I've wanted to do has always been like involved in music, even like different areas of like maybe getting into like, you know, sound design for motion pictures and things like that.
True,
you know,
true.
Different avenues of the same thing, but not really necessarily like being a front and
being an artist. I think that would be a big mistake.
You think so?
Absolutely.
Yeah, well, it hasn't happened yet.
Yeah, well,
I already have the next one planned. I have to End It All. So,
so End It All, not so much.
Not so much, no. The next one's going to be called Love Me Tonight.
You're kidding.
Nah.
Is this going to be the tender, vulnerable side of Beans?
Nah, never. Not in that blatant of a way. It's just, okay. I just really dislike the title.
You just like the title Love Me Tonight.
I just like the title Love Me Tonight.
And by love, you mean exactly what?
Well, not love, not in the sense of like the emotion or anything, but I just think a lot of things stem with me from the title. Like, okay. I'll come up with the title first.
Sure.
And then the music will come, or the lyrics will come after the title. So I'll have like a series of titles and then fit it to the title. So far, Love Me Tonight hasn't like manifested what it's gonna be about
okay,
yet.
I just have
the title for it.
And you you had a line in Blind Driver, walk a tightrope wearing two left shoes.
Yeah.
And one of the things I find with your work is that there's so many words, and I mean your cadence is so precise and and it's very erudite, but then you'll come out with a line. And it's funny because I'll be stuck on that line and I'll be missing the next six lines because I'm like stuck on, you know, I'm visualizing walking a tightrope with two left shoes.
Right.
Which is, you know, which
yeah,
is
that's
very
funny. I think with the next album, I decided to print the lyrics.
you're going to have a book then?
Yeah, it's going to be like the lyrics will be printed. I'm actually working on a book too.
Oh, okay.
We're going to have a book called Navigation to Nowhere.
Mm.
It's about boy meets girl, boy loses girl, and boy kills Manny.
Any related to the girl?
Yeah, it's based on some life experiences, but I'm abstracting it in the sense that, you know,
okay.
That it's creative.
Okay.
You know?
So boy meets girl, boy loses girl.
And boy kills Manny.
Boy goes on rampage.
Yeah, boy kills Manny.
Okay.
Yeah, Navigation to Nowhere.
Mm. So that sounds like a kind of noirish, or
yeah, it's kind of noirish. I read a lot.
The killer inside me,
something like that.
The killer inside me, uh-huh.
Yeah, something like
okay.
that.
Okay, okay.
But yo, how's everything being with Living Color?
It's good. It's good. It has its ups and its downs. You know, being in a band for a long time is a trip. It's a trip. You have your good days. You have your great days, you know, and you have your why am I doing this to myself days, and why am I doing this to them days, you know. Right? So it's good. We just finished doing a tour. I was playing Jimi Hendrix music. We did a Experience Hendrix thing. But we're switching managers now. We're going through what are we doing next, you know, our next record, what are we talking about, where are we going. So we're in a transition.
What would you like to do?
What would I like to do? God, that's a great question. I mean, in a way, I think I want to get more detailed with the music. I mean, I don't even know what that means, but I kind of feel like, you know, I kind of want to push the limits of what we're capable of doing. And I'm thinking about that an actual composition, and then lyrically as well. You know, like, because Living Color is an American band that's engaged in a particular conversation, you know, because we're, you know, African American, black, Negro, fill in the blank, N-word, whatever. And we're engaged in this conversation that's, I think, you know, unique among American bands. You know, because we play a kind of heavy music, but it's mixed with funk, it's mixed with jazz, it's a conglomerate. Metal's in there, the metal's a big part of it. But culturally, you know, and how we identify, we totally identify with blues and Ornette Coleman and James Brown, and that's where we're coming from. There's a lot of metal, it's coming from classical music. It's really coming from Wagner. And we're very much a part of, I mean, of the blues part, but we're also part of the, you know, I came from the avant-garde in terms of jazz and things like that.
Right.
So, and I heard the track, and you said, I'm the Ornette Coleman of this nation. And I would absolutely agree.
Thank you, sir.
I would absolutely agree. I mean, you're just, I think you're an easily misunderstood kind of artist, and I can totally relate to it. You know, I can totally relate to the odd man out kind of thing, because I feel that in my own part of the scenario.
Right. Yeah, I was mainly asking you about Living Color in the context of anti-pop as well. You know, for my own.
How's it for you?
Interesting. I mean, we broke up for a period of 5 years.
We did the same thing.
I know. Our situations are very parallel in that sense.
Yeah.
You know, I find it very challenging. You know,
what's the most challenging thing about it?
Compromise.
Okay.
The compromise, the personalities, certain personalities, you know. But what I really enjoy about the experience is the music.
Okay.
I still enjoy the music that's being made.
You know, it's funny, I was a huge fan of Anti-Pop when it first came up.
Right.
And of course, when Anti-Pop broke up, I mean, it was like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I was like that too.
But I completely understand. Right. I completely understand. And it's sort of like, when I was a fan of the Mahavishnu Orchestra or a fan of the Beatles or the Bad Brains, you know, when the Bad Brains, when, you know, HR split to do human rights.
Right.
And from the outside, you go, oh, man, it's so, you know, but when you don't get it till you're on the inside of that. When you're on the inside of that cauldron of disappointment, expectations, betrayals, whatever they are, disagreements.
Yeah. I'm not entirely blameless, but
nobody is. Are you having different arguments, or are you having the same conflict?
It's still kind of the same conflict. I'm sure that certain same conflicts still arise, you know? But the music is the music. I really enjoy the music.
Yeah.
You know, there's certain things in hip hop that I would like to see. Like, for example, I would like to see shorter length of records, but longer songs, stretching out, not necessarily being so like club orientated, but having like movements and changes and things like that, and having the vocals become part of that strategically within those changes. And I think that, you know, that's the type of things I would like to see Anti-Pop do, like, you know. And I think we could, you know, do that.
Yeah, so, you know, it's kind of like, it's almost time for prog rap.
Exactly.
You know, I mean, there was a point at which when we were working together, we were right on the verge of kind of punk rap.
Yeah. Feather and treasure
triumph. Final finally cably constant reception receiving the motorload stir fry beans. But I think that the notion of prog rap is a really powerful one. I mean, when I think about like R. Kelly's The Closet,
right.
It's a funny thing because that record, it's essentially one insanely involved story. And it's one beat, you know, it's one cut. And I love the impulse. Like, he had an impulse to doing something very, very challenging.
Right.
People hate that record, too. You know, like, people like, oh, it's the worst.
No, I love that.
But I loved the insanity of it. And it's kind of like the Divine Styler record.
You Spiral know, Walls Containing Lines of Light.
Oh, a masterpiece.
That is one of the most slept on.
I know that had a big effect on you, bro.
Big time.
I know that did. Big I know time. It did.
That album is incredible.
It's seminal.
It's a very seminal record. Very seminal record and very influential to me. You know, he did things above and beyond that still haven't been touched on.
And news! More bluesy news!
It is a kind of spiritual cry for help.
Right.
A cry for answers. A cry out into the void. I mean, that's my interpretation of it. And very, very powerful. And I know that was a, you know what I mean?
Because can't front.
You know, because
can't front. It did very much did.
Yeah.
Still does to this day, still.
Yeah, and I kind of feel like your work is taking you've taken your own path, but that impulse to not follow convention, to actually have your own voice, whatever that means. I mean, I completely recognize it. You know, I get it. You know, I mean, I feel like
that's because you do the same.
Yeah, and when you take that on, you really kind of walk a lonely path. I mean, you walk a path, you know, like freedom is seldom traveled by the multitudes. I mean, that's kind of a cliche, but it really is true. And we've been produced by a culture that's so rich, but it's also incredibly conservative at its core.
I agree.
And that's one of the huge conundrums. So what I want to say about being in a band, sometimes it's good for you not to get your way. You know, as much as it sucks. I mean, there's a part of me that I always want my way because my way is best, but that's not really true.
I have a song called "If I'm Wrong, Then Who's Right."
Right, and sometimes I mean it can be incredibly frustrating to have. You know, when you've had breakthroughs, and it's like, why can't it always be like that all the time?
Right.
You know, but people are, you know, different cats on the same squad are there for different reasons, you know. You can all have a skill set that puts you on the level to be in the same squad. But, you know, one cat's there to prove something to his dad. One cat's there to prove something to his mom. One cat's there to prove something to his younger brother. One cat's there to prove something to himself.
Right.
Everybody's got there. Everybody's on the level. But intentions, motivations. What are you going to do? You can't end it all, bro.
I guess not. Looking like I don't have much of a choice now. Looking like I don't have much of a choice, really.
That's the whole point. The fact that you don't have a choice is exactly why you can't stop. You know what I mean? If you had other things to do, other skill sets, other aesthetics, you got to follow those because I think of it like it's all the same. It's all coming out of the same source. So
right.
If you want to write, paint, you know, I mean, you have to apply. I think of it as applying an aesthetic, a central aesthetic that is expressed in different mediums. But you have a, you're, I mean, The first time I heard you, I was you know, I've been blown away the whole time. You know?
I remember that day too.
And I remember like going, what?
Yeah, I remember that day. Uh-huh. You was in the audience, introduced to by through Tate.
Yeah. Yeah, Greg Tate. A lot of us met through Greg Tate. Yep.
That's a lot of people you met through Greg?
Oh yeah.
Have you spoken to Greg?
Yeah, I talk to Greg all the time.
How's he doing?
He's doing great. Yeah. He would love to hear from you. You should call him.
Yeah, I need to.
You know, Greg's doing great. He's got this this thing, Burnt Sugar.
Yeah.
And I mean, I have so much respect for him for really, it's an amazing ensemble. When are we going to play again? Yeah, do something.
Oh yeah, I have some ideas.
If you got a track, then
yeah, Megalodon. That's for the next
Megalodon.
One. Yeah, I love it. Yeah, I'm working on it. I'm working with this guy named Gary War. He used to work with Ariel Paint, and he does his own solo stuff. It was really wild. I'm sorry, I work with him for Love Me Tonight.
Okay,
some tracks. So
very cool.
Yeah, I'm really going there with the extended format and
interesting.
Yeah, interesting. I want like a horn section and all that.
Wow.
Yeah, I want to really like.
All right.
I'm going there. Next one, I'm really going there.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's time. Hip hop is kind of too safe right now. So everything's so, as you said, everything's conservative. Everything's for the club, or it's so. There's no element of surprise anymore.
It's also disconnected from the way people are living. I mean.
Right. Very.
It's
somewhat elitist, actually.
It's very interesting. It is very much of a kind of velvet rope. It's in a velvet rope mode that's kind of really disturbing because people are, I mean, I guess the economy is slowly turning around, but people have been broke, you know, people have been, you know, living on the dole, and the music has not really spoke to that.
I just can't emphasize enough how disconnected it is from the people who actually listen to that music, you know, And then certain people are trying to emulate. I wouldn't say. Well, they are actually trying to live what they're hearing, and it's not. Right. It's such a great, you know, disconnect. I agree with everything you're saying.
You know.
Actually, I've been saying it for years.
Yeah, man. I got to interview you.
Okay.
But I started a podcast called The Field Negro Guide to Arts and Culture. And it's a podcast that I've been doing with a comedian. He's a stand-up comedian named W. Kamau Bell, who's from San Francisco. And we met via Twitter, and we just hit it off. He did something for the Fringe Fest. He had a show called Ending Racism in Just Under an Hour. And we got a chance to talking, and then a few conversations later, we wound up doing, you know, recording a thing. And we're into our, we just did our sixth episode. We did an episode all about Fishbone. And I had interviewed Ernie Isley while I was out on the tour, on the Hendrix tour. And one of the things that I want to do is talk to all different kinds of artists. We also just kind of talk about current events and movies and whatever's happening, whatever's clever. But you would be fantastic. You started working with electronic instrumental music. Quite aside from,
you mean like the Blank Slates?
Yeah,
like that? Yeah. The Blank Slates was a group consisting of saxophone, drum machine, synth. You know, it was myself, High Priest, Micah Goth, and Manny.
Oh,
yeah. You know, when I was working at other music, got more exposed to like the music concrete stuff.
Sure.
You know. Oh, I've always been into that, you know. Art Tucker is one of my biggest influences.
Yeah, sure.
You know,
wonderful.
You know, Doc Stanley.
You like Amon Tobin?
I like Amon Tobin, yeah. Yeah, but to me, Art Tucker is hands down. Because I link what Art Tucker does to Mantronics. I think
that's interesting.
Yeah, I think they're like, I think they took off where Mantronics stopped.
That's interesting.
me is like one of the unsung heroes of early like hip hop production.
Well, that was there was sort of like live band playing.
Right.
Then there was the emergence of sampling.
Right.
And then there was this whole other part of it that was kind of electronic, which is like really like the soul sonic force.
Exactly.
Play at your own risk.
Right.
And, you know, the Arthur Baker scenario.
Yeah. Not to be nostalgic, but that's what always inspired me about hip-hop is that it did go into all these directions, but it was still considered hip-hop.
Funny thing about rock and roll was, you know, when I came into it, I kind of came into it from sort of like Hendrix and Santana and whatnot, and there was this whole idea of a kind of freedom of, you know, kind of cathartic freedom to express yourself. And as I got more into it, you know, it seemed like they were kind of rules of, you know, there were kind of rules where you kind of do it like this, or you have to do it like that, and you have to be like this or be like that. And it always kind of bothered me because it was like, well, why do I have to be a particular way to do this? You know, I should be able to be the way I am.
Right.
And that was one of the things that led to the Black Rock Coalition and the formation of that community, was the whole notion of, you know, because Americans love to say, you see so many movies where, you know, there's a certain part of the script where some character says to another character, be yourself, which is on a level absolutely true, but it's absolutely false in America. You know, I mean, in America it's really all about, in so many ways, you know, be not yourself, but be this kind of idealized idea of yourself, a better you than you are. And if you don't attain that better you, then you should feel bad about it. Because if you don't have the nice clothes, the nice car, if you don't have, you know, high cheekbones like you, you know what I'm saying? It's a problem.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And that's one of the things that, you know, we should be able to be where we are, exactly where we are, and make it happen.
When was this a year around when you started the BRC?
She started in 85. And it was funny, just a series of just calling friends up, saying, hey, man, am I crazy? that's basically it. And it kind of came from there. You know, just saying, you know, is this experience I'm having in attempting to play the music I want to play, am I the only one having that experience? And that was what that's basically the essential premise. And then as people came into that conversation, you know, the notion of talking about stereotyping and typecasting and the narrowness of the industry and racism in the industry, that emerged, but it really started out with just pinging out there to see if there was an echo back.
When you guys started getting together, was there talk about like starting your own label and just doing it?
That's one of the most, you know, that's like sort of like the path not taken. You know what I mean? Like, should it have been a label? You know, it's always been member supported. You know, it's always been broke. Always just kind of did it through membership and doing the shows that we do. And there was a definite decision for it to not be a label, because then if it had become a label, it would have turned into that kind. It would have ceased being a kind of community, and it would have become a business in a particular way. And at that time, you know, people didn't want to do that.
How do you look at Afropunk now?
Well, Afropunk is really interesting, and I think they are a necessary outgrowth of the same conversation for another generation.
Right.
In a weird way, Afropunk is both a repudiation of the Black Rock Coalition and an affirmation of what the Black Rock Coalition is.
Right.
You know, because it is the same impulse towards an alternative way of being black is, you know, it's a powerful thing. And whether or not it falls in line exactly with the principles of the early organization, you know, like, the one thing that Afropunk has done is that they've got corporate sponsorship. You know, when they do their things, they have Mountain Dew, right. Toyota, you know, and you know that's been a part of how they've been able to pay the bills and do their thing. And the other thing is that they really tied in to the notion of sports, which I think was brilliant. As far as the corporate part of it, you know, I have no judgment of that in the sense, I mean, that's a path that we didn't take. But, you know, when I go to the Afropunk festivals right here, the BAM, they have like a thing, they had a thing over here at the BAM Opera House, in the parking lot. I thought it was great.
That's cool.
You know?
What you got coming up next?
Well, I'm going to be touring with Jack Bruce and the bass player from Cream, Cindy Blackman, great drummer, and John Medeski, who's a keyboard player from Medeski, Martin, and Wood. And we do music Tony Williams.
Oh, wow.
Tony Williams' lifetime music, and you know, because Jack Bruce actually played with Tony Williams,
right,
back in the day. And so we had done a week in Tokyo, and it was fantastic. And so we're going to be doing touring and recording early next year. At some point next year, Living Color is going to get back in the studio. I'm going to be doing some solo stuff, and want to do some more producing. I've been producing James Bud Omer, a bunch of blues records, and I have a project in mind for him. So, yeah, but so what are you going to be up to?
Well, right now, End It All is coming out. It's the first album I have on Anti-Con.
Okay.
And that's coming out February 15th. And then Anti-Pop did another record with Matthew Shipp.
All right.
Called Nods from Heaven. I think it's coming out in February as well. And then I'm just going to be like touring and then working on Love Me Tonight. But, you know, I just wanted to end it, you know, and just say that, you know, if it wasn't really for you, you know, you really like saw something in me that allowed me to be able to do this. I mean, you were the first person to take me out like touring. You know, you showed me the world, you know, and I've always appreciated and looked up to you for that, you know. And thank you. You have my greatest gratitude for that,
of course,
man.
My
big brother for that.
Oh,
man.
Please. Well, you're not my little brother. That's what, you know what I mean? I tell you, I really appreciate that. And, you know, like Ronald Shannon Jackson, the great drummer who played with Ornette Coleman, he took me out on the road. He was the first person to take me seriously.
I remember when we played with him in Russia.
Yeah.
Poland.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah. And it is something that's transmitted from generation to generation. If you see something, he saw something in me. And when I went to Europe the first time, I got to see Muddy Waters, you know, on stage. And that was the greatest thing. And so when I heard you, I was like, this guy's the next, he's, you know what I mean? Everyone else is nice. That kid right there. And so it was a no-brainer to have you involved with my music, and you killed it every night. You were the man in the comfy chair, and you always do your thing. And I'm still a fan, and hopefully we'll get a chance to do some stuff again in the future. But
I'm sure we will. Megalodon, we'll work that out.
All right, we'll work that out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Watch this and other Brooklyn Independent Television episodes online at breakartsmedia.org/bit.